Welcome to a retrospective about Vic and Sade, a program about an extraordinary, ordinary family, written by Paul Reimer. Vic and Sade ran as a 15-minute show from June 29, 1932, to September 29, 1944. It returned with additional characters for 5 months in 1945, and as a 30-minute broadcast with a live audience in 1946 as a summer replacement for Fibber McGee and Molly. The show featured Art Van Harvey as Vic and Bernardine Flynn as Sade. A couple of weeks after the inception of the program, a juvenile role was added, that of Rush, played by Bill Idelson. In August of 1940, Sade's Uncle Fletcher joined the cast. He was portrayed by Clarence Hartzell and certainly put his stamp on the program. It was January of 1943 when Bill Idelson left for service in the Naval Air Force. In June of that year, a new juvenile role was added to the program, that of Russell. Russell was younger than Rush when he left, but had the same friends and got into the same kinds of adventures that Rush did. A young man was brought in to play the role of Russell, and we have that very same young man with us today, David Whitehouse. The longtime sponsor of Vic and Sade was Procter & Gamble, particularly for its product known as Crisco. The tagline for it was, "It's digestible." Nowadays, a Crisco label says, "No trans fat." Many of the transcriptions of Vic and Sade were stored at the Procter & Gamble headquarters in Cincinnati. When the building was altered, most of the recordings were destroyed, and others have disappeared through the years. Fortunately, however, due primarily to the efforts of one organization, the Friends of Vic and Sade, we have available to us approximately 10% of the more than 3,500 programs that were produced. For 35 years, the Friends of Vic and Sade has been a one-person operation. Every radio or TV show should have a fan as conscientious and as dedicated as Barbara Schwarz.
Thank you. Yes, no, this has been a labor of love. It's been a wonderful hobby. And I just thought, and of all things, I just was informed by David of something that I didn't know before, so it never ends. And I will be researching that to document the change that he told me about.
I'd like to welcome you, David, to your first Friends of Old Time Radio Convention.
Thank you.
It's great to have you with us here today. Please tell us about your early life and how things led up to your auditioning for Vic and Sade.
Do I have to do it in the young voice, Martin? Or can I? Oh, this is a great pleasure to be here to enjoy Vic and Sade with you all, particularly Barbara. This is just an incredible experience for me. I was the last of nine children, believe it or not, and all within 12 years. And I had a lot of older brothers and sisters who sort of led the way. I had a brother who would sing Gilbert and Sullivan on the stage and dance around, and so I learned a lot from him. I consider myself to be one of the luckiest guys in the world. If you think about it, being the last of nine children, the probability of being here today is pretty small. Anyway, I am here, and I was very active as a child. My father and mother were both musicians. And although none of their children were musicians, but they encouraged us greatly. And part of my acting experience is sort of generated by the interest of my brothers and sisters. I was in the Children's Theater in Evanston, Illinois, and that was quite a show at that time. It was very famous. The director of that Children's Theater was nationally known, and I ended up seventh grade playing Little Black Sambo. And I had black paint over my whole body, and I was eating pancakes on the stage and really acting up like a 13-year-old. My goodness, I don't, as I look back at it, I say, how did I do that? You know, it really wasn't me. And then in the eighth grade, we played The Emperor's New Clothes. And The Emperor's New Clothes was so well done that they took it to the Washington National Theater in Washington, D.C. We all took a train ride and went into Washington. So my experience in acting, although it was not my considered profession, I was having a lot of fun. And then the director of the Children's Theater one day in my seventh grade, came to me and says, they're looking for a child actor in Chicago. Would you like to go try out for it? And since I had the experience of not being afraid of going in front of people and doing things a little out of the ordinary, this looked like an opportunity to take advantage of. And believe it or not, my mother put me on the elevated from Evanston to Chicago all by myself. You think about this, in today's world, you just wouldn't do that. And I arrived at the Merchandise Mart. It was a tremendous big building, and took the 19th floor up and was greeted by, Vic, Sade, Uncle Fletcher, and Paul Reimer. And that was quite an experience. Not really knowing the whole story with the background of this, I marched right in and did my little reading, and Paul was in the corner of the room, and Vic and Sade were sitting at the table doing their part. And basically they said, thank you very much. I said, okay. Said goodbye. And then they notified me that I had the part. Now, I have no understanding of why I got the part more than anyone else, and I don't really know how many other people auditioned for the part. But I saw this as a real opportunity. These opportunities, when they come along, don't always come along that often, and so I was taught to take advantage of opportunities when they're there. So that basically is how I got involved in the original audition.
Let me show the picture.
Not yet.
Okay.
What was it like as a youngster to be associated with a nationally broadcast radio show and to work with the people connected with Vic and Sade?
These were very unusual people, but both in their personal characteristics and in their plot line of the Vic and Sade. I have a video here. Did somebody turn that off? Is the light still on the projector?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, can we wake it up? Wake up.
I don't know.
The light's on.
The light's on, yeah.
Hit play. Okay. That's what I thought I did. There we go.
There we are.
Okay. So yes. Let's pause that for a moment. That was the studio on the 19th floor of the Merchandise Mart. It was a room about 20 feet by 20 feet. The walls were sort of covered by a sound-absorbing material that was black and gold, not very bright per se. And Vic and Sade were sitting at a table. And in this case, they had what's called a gooseneck microphone. So it was over the table and would feed down between the two of them. There was another microphone behind my head that both I and Clarence would do our actors of Russell and Uncle Fletcher. And there's Paul Reimer posing in this picture with his hat. He always seemed to have his hat with him, which was pretty much a good characteristic. The windows behind was the control room. So behind those windows, the director was there, and when he had a comment to make with us, there's a loudspeaker on the wall in the back. He would come through the loudspeaker and say, do this or do that, or have a comment about it. The entrance to the whole studio was actually a double door, very heavy double doors, sort of coming in toward where Vic and Sade are sitting, so that to eliminate any extraneous sound from coming in from the hallway. And these were almost like jail doors. They were so heavy. You had to pull them open, and they were very well padded with sound-absorbent material. And so I would spend the day getting on the elevated in the morning, and spend a half an hour walking to the elevated station in Evanston, and take another hour and a half trip down to the Merchandise Mart. And I began to like to do it so much that the conductor on the railroad train got to know me, and he let me help him open the doors and help people on and off. So I was kind of a do-it guy in that sense. I liked to get involved with things, conductor was a great guy, and we had good chats. Sometimes I would go up in the elevator with very famous people. I remember one day Hildegard. I don't know do they remember the name of Hildegard, but she waltzed onto the elevator in this flowing gown. I was stunned. At that point, I didn't say too much. I just looked. And that was fun, seeing Hildegard in person like that.
David, is that Clarence Hartzell?
That is Clarence Hartzell, believe it or not. As Barbara said, he joined when he was like 28 years old. Mm-hmm. And this was like maybe 4 years later. So he was in his early 30s at that point in time. Just an amazing guy. You know, he was sort of inconsequential when he walked in the room and not assuming in any way. And then when he took this voice, it just blew me away. You know, it's just such an unusual presentation that he was able to present to the radio audience. I think the best fun I had was in the names that Paul Reimer came up with. It's just incredible. I've jotted down a few here. Chuck and Dottie Brain Feeble, of course. How do you come up with a name like Brain Feeble? You know, you got to have an interesting one. And Ruth and Fred Stembottom. Ike Kleberger. Ike Knee Surfer. Who ever saw anyone surf on their knees, you know, but that's the name he came up with. Lolita Di Rienzi. Gumpox the Garbage Man. Oliver Hammersweet. Olive Hammersweet was Vic's secretary. And then there was a Charlie Razor Scum. Okay? You know, and these names would come on the script. I would usually show up like an hour and a half ahead of time and go over my part with the director. And then Vic and Sade would come in maybe half an hour before the show started. And I would just break up in my rehearsal with the director over these names. And then twin brothers, BB and Boo Boo Baugh, and Bracey and Stafy Yoff, who were the inventors of Stingberry Jam. And Stingberry Jam churns, rise, crawls, and breathes in the bottle. And it's green, bubbly, cloudy, and funny. Can you think of the imagination that this gentleman had in coming up with those names? And by the way, Richigan Fishigan from Sishigan, Michigan did have a different name, but you remember the name of his wife?
Jane Dane.
Yeah. Very good. Excellent.
Yes.
Jane Dane from Payne, Maine.
Yes. You caught
his alliterations in something like that were incredible, how he would do that. And Russell's, and I guess Rush's also, favorite movie star was four-fisted Frank Futtleman.
Yes.
And his counterpart as the female was Gloria Golden in the GG, Gloria Golden. So just the name issue, which just blew me away as a youngster. You know, nothing like that ever happened in my home or with my friends. And the names that they called me, I was called Stove Lid, Stone Bruise, Foot Pedal, I was often called by Vic, Dr. Sleech, and I got some female names, and I was called Helen, Dorothy, Sarah, Willie, and Uncle Fletcher always called me Russell Honey. Of course, he called everybody Vic Honey, Sade Honey, but Russell Honey always used to get me. Anyway, that was my experience with this. Incredible show. Right, there you go. There are just so many of them.
Yeah.
I went through a few of my programs and was able to pull out a few of them. But you could write a book or chapters just on the names themselves, and it always amazed me. So that's pretty much my stay at and my experience. Yes.
Were you familiar with the show before you auditioned?
I had heard of it, but my mother and father were busy taking care of 9 kids, and so we really didn't listen to much radio at home, right? So it was sort of a total new thing for me. But once we got into it and saw all the people that were interested in it, then we quickly became interested. Yeah. Yes.
Do either of you happen to remember the names?
That was from the 1946 show, The Half an Hour, that there was this trial revival of Vic and Sade in 1946, and they went on the air for a half a year. It was a half an hour. There was an audience. And a number of famous, well-known Chicago actors were given speaking parts. But it just didn't work right. It just didn't work right. I would like to make a comment about the names. As David said, the names were just a delight. Every script that I ever read, there was always somebody new in there. And I have a member, Dr. Richard Hunton, and he calls himself Dr. Sleech, his nickname. And he has gone through every script that I have ever reproduced and sent to the members, and every episode that we have in our collection, and extracted a list of all those names. It runs to about 30 pages. It is just amazing. Paul's imagination knew no bounds. And in relation to that, since Bill isn't here, I want to tell you that Bill Idelson wanted to come to this convention so much. But unfortunately, in June, he fell and broke his hip. And other complications arose from there. Yes. Yes, the lady is asking our opinion as to why the 1946 program did not work. And what else?
Why
the show was canceled.
Yes,
yeah. I think it had, it's my personal opinion, and I've talked to Bill about this. He just felt that it had, television was on the horizon. Radio was changing to some degree, and the magic of Vic and Sade was lost in a long format. It was because we used our imaginations to think about all these friends and neighbors and what they may have sounded like and what have you, and it just didn't fit the format. I mean, the 15-minute was a treasure. Even 1945... there was another 15-minute Vic and Sade show on Mutual, and again, it was 15 minutes. It, but they brought in speaking voices for the friends and neighbors, and that didn't work well. There was just something. Sometimes you get a formula, and if you break it, it just doesn't work. Yeah, it just doesn't work. Yes.
I have a question for David.
Yeah. Oh, Tom, would you get a...
Let me get the mic.
Yeah.
The answer is yes, 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 and no. Now the question.
I have a gentleman in the balcony. Yeah, this is a question for David. You went into this, and obviously you talked about the experiences that you had and so on. I'm curious as to your feelings, like... did you go in knowing that you were only going to be on there, first of all, for a short time, and secondly, after you had been there for a while, and I think 11-year-old or something, what your feelings were like when that period came to an end as far as...
Well, thank you for the question. Yeah, it's I did not go in with any assumed tenure in this spot. It was fun. By the way, in case you want to know how much I was paid, my mother, believe it or not, turned out to be my trustee, and she saved all of my check slips. And I found these like 10 years ago when my brother delivered me all the papers that my mother had left. I actually earned $40 a day.
Oh.
And that was pretty good at that time.
Yeah.
And that certainly helped put me through my education since I was on it for about 15 months.
Thank you.
It turns out that my life is more taking advantage of opportunities as they arise. When the program was terminated, I was obviously disappointed, but I had picked up a few other minor parts in other radio shows, and I continued in minor parts until I was a senior in high school. And then my interests turned to engineering and science, and away I went. And I've had a ball in that life ever since. But that's for another chapter.
Who owns the rights to Vic and Sade now?
That's really a good question. The truth is that I discovered that back in the late 70s, early 80s, that Mrs. Reimer had control of the rights. I thought it was NBC, but it was Mrs. Reimer. Mrs. Reimer passed away. That authority passed to their only son, Park. And Park was helpful to me for several years. And whenever I needed some authority, he would give it to me. But unfortunately, Park is retired, and he has disappeared and not told me where he is. It was very interesting. I'll be honest with you. Mrs. Reimer is Bill has told this to me. Bill did not feel that Mrs. Reimer really understood what her husband did. She never had quite the sense of humor that Paul did, but she recognized that. He wrote well, and that resulted in these two books. But really, I wish I knew where Park Reimer was, because there are some things I'd like to ask him. But it's lost in limbo at this point. Yeah,
I think with regard to your question about cancellation of the show. One thing I've heard is that the advertising agency for Procter & Gamble was changed, and the people in the new agency wanted something different. That's it. Or straight ahead. It always had a twist of lemon to it.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Radio was changing, too. There's no two ways about it. The agencies were having, they've always, until, I don't know, people, you historians about agencies probably know better than I do, but the control for many years, of course, about shows and advertising and what have you, the agency had a great deal of control over radio programs. So it's one of the unanswered questions.
Fitz Shampoo came on as a sponsor after that for the 15-minute program, mm-hmm. and then there were TV pilots in 47, 49, 51, yeah. 57, we think.
Yeah.
And one of them is available on DVD and tape from, I think, 57?
Yeah, it was a kinescope. It's a black. I always have seen it in black and white, a very grainy kinescope. But I just found out recently NBC had broadcast it in color in 57, but I've never seen a color copy.
Barbara, as I recall it, this was actually a televised version of a radio show. Aren't they
yes.
sitting almost as David pictured here yeah. at a table
yes.
and a microphone?
Yes. Do you remember those funny slingback canvas chairs? They were kind of three-pointed and what have you. And they're in this studio, and Art and the young man who took Rush's part, Eddie Gillian, they're sitting in the slingbacks, and Sade is sitting at a small table with a notebook in front of her with the script. Art and Eddie have their notebooks in their laps. And I was told that it was done in that format because Vic was off and on ailing. He was not well, and rather than try to get him to try to memorize a script, they always had the script available for him to read. So it's all they did was just take a previously written radio script and update it a little bit, and Eddie Gillian did a pretty good job as a Rush in this program. But it's such a grainy picture. It's really like a bad Xerox.
It's just interesting to see them in action for once.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is there anything else before we close? 2 minutes?
I can add one little comment to the termination of the regular series, because I just re-listened to the last program, which was of the regular series in 1944, where everybody went off into their own directions, both Sade, Vic, Uncle Fletcher, and Russell. And then at the end, the announcer said, Vic and Sade are going to go on a vacation for a while, and they will be back soon. And what that tells me was that there were some negotiations going on in the background between the advertisers and NBC as to just what should happen to this program. And it's obvious to me at that point that it was just time for it to change to something else, unfortunately.
Yes.
Are you talking about long-term or at the end of the regular series? Yeah, at the end of the regular series, they were fine. I don't know what happened during the TV.
The actors that played Vic and Sade didn't get along.
Yes, we have to cut. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, thank you all for coming.
But at the end, they were fine. You're saying, okay, well, thank you, David, Barbara, everyone, for the joining in the fine program.